Here at home watching. God is so good. He gives us what we need when we need it, and He doesn't hold back. We're going to praise, we're going to worship, worship in giving, worship with your heart, worship with your song, and then Pastor Mark has a wonderful service for us. I'm Valerie. This is my husband, Max. I want to embarrass our daughter. She's over there, the blonde. That's Eden. And then our son Caleb is on the camera. And we serve a great God, and we love our church family. So thank you, guys.
When the road runs dead, you can see the way I don't.
Yes.
And it makes no sense, but you say that's what faith is for. When I see a flood, you see a promise. When I see a grave, you see a door. And when I'm at my end, you see where the future starts.
Come on, sing it out.
I don't know how you make a It's not like you don't have a plan. And when the earth gives way on this rock, your church will stand. 'Cause nothing has ever once surprised you, and nothing has ever made you flinch. And when it all shakes out, the gates of hell don't stand a chance. I don't know how you make no way. Make a way, but I know you will. You've been good on every promise, from even to sign to every day. And out of that grave, I don't know how you make a way, but I know you will.
'Cause you pulled my heart from me, chip. You carved a road through sea. My life shades to it.
In this place, He's going to make a way where there seemed to be no way. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Did you come to worship this morning? Amen. Amen. We've reached the point in our service where if you have a need in this place, our elders, our spiritual leaders, are going to make their way around this altar area and up in the aisles and at the back. If you have a need in this place, it doesn't matter if you know how He's going to make the way possible. But you can stand here today and know He will. I said you can know that He will. God is good. Amen. Wow. So if you have a need in this place, and if you see someone that you want to agree with in prayer, just stretch your hand out and agree with them in prayer as we continue to worship. He's moving in this place this morning, and we're going to continue to love and worship our God. Hallelujah.
Storm, stir with
I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know you more. I surrender. I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know you more. Like a rushing wind,
Jesus, breathe within. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way. Like a mighty soul, stir with this soul. Lord, have your ways. Lord, have your way in me.
Like a rushing wind, Jesus, breathe within. Lord, have your way.
The best.
don't have to wait till the battle's over. I can shout now. I don't have to wait till the battle's over. I can shout now. I don't have to wait till the battle's over. I can shout now.
Well, we might as well just shout a little bit. We might as well give praise. We might as well lean into what God is doing in our lives. Amen. We might as well trust that God is able. He's capable. He is mighty. He is strong in battle. Whatever you are facing today, whatever struggle you are up against, whatever mountain is in your way, you need to know that our God is bigger. He's stronger. He's more powerful. And here's what's even better. He loves you. He loves you. He cares for you. He is actively involved in your life. He's more than just an idea. He's more than just a philosophy. He's more than just something you read in a book. He is the living, loving, and ever-powerful God. And whatever you are facing, He is right there with you. Let's pray today. Let me pray for you if you're facing anything. In fact, if you're facing something, if you just, you're up against it, would you just raise a hand real quick so I can know? Yeah, your hand's going up all across this place. God is here for you and He's here with you. Heavenly Father, I pray right now for every person who raised their hand signifying that they are facing down an obstacle. There's a mountain in their way. There is something that they feel they cannot overcome. Lord, I pray right now that they would begin to feel the wind of the Holy Spirit lifting them up, carrying them forward. I pray that they would feel your strength surging through their heart, surging through their mind. I pray that most importantly, they would feel your presence close to them. And Lord, we thank you for what you're doing already. We thank you for pathways that you are opening up, doors that you are swinging wide open. We thank you for power that you are releasing to us right now. We stand in faith. We lean into your presence. And we trust in the knowledge deep down in our hearts that you are good and you love us because your word tells us that and your word never changes. Lord, we thank you for what your Spirit is doing. We thank you for the power and the presence that we feel right now. We glorify you. We lift you up. And in Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen. Aren't you glad you came to church already? We are so glad that you are here worshiping with us today, whether you are in person or whether you're online. Thank you for praising God with us here at Crossroads Church. It's more than just a song service. It's more than just something you attend. It's family. Thank you for being a part of our family. You may be seated today. We have a lot of things going on. I just want to say just very quickly, two quick things. Number one, I want to say a special thank you to Holly Stimson and her team that decorated our main spaces. It looks absolutely wonderful. They spent hours upon hours getting our campus ready for the Christmas season. I also want to say thank you to everybody that participated in our holiday market yesterday. Yesterday was Small Business Saturday, and we had over 40 local vendors here in our event center, and it was busy all day long. We were able to collect diapers and things that we could give and donate to the Hope Pregnancy Center to continue our partnership with them as they resource young women, young families. And it was also just a great opportunity to help support local businesses. So thank you so much to everybody who helped put that on and made that a success. Well, like I said, there's a lot of things going on at Crossroads Church. We have an announcement video that we've prepared for you guys. So please turn your attention to the screen for a few announcements.
Are you curious about what's going on at Crossroads Church? Make sure to download our Church Center app. You can find information about online giving, upcoming events, and our classes.
Based on the beloved film from 1964, this musical will follow the life of George Bailey, from his childhood dreams to his midlife disappointments and beyond. Join us as we discover whether his life has been worth it or not.
Come and experience a message of hope and redemption this Christmas season here at Crossroads Church on December 16th and 17th at 7 p.m. and again on the 18th at 10 a.m. You're all invited.
Did you know that we offer online giving? You could go to crossroads.church/give and choose the ministries and initiatives that you would like to donate to. You can also give by card at the kiosks that we have across campus.
Hey Crossroads family, God did some amazing things in 2022, and I have faith he's going to do even more amazing things in 2023. I am so excited to announce Launch Week beginning Sunday, January 8th. We are going to be continuing with Seek Night. Now you may be asking, Pastor Adam, what is Seek Night? Well, it's just that. We come together as a family and we seek the Holy Spirit. We seek God's Spirit. We seek to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We seek to be empowered by God's Spirit. All of that is happening Sunday, January 8th. And then I am also super excited to announce our very own spiritual leaders guest speaking the rest of that week. Starting on January 10th, we have Joe DiPaolo, who is going to be delivering what I know to be a powerful message. I'm so excited to hear what God is continuing to do in and through him. And then following Joe DiPaolo, we have Charlie Barton on January 11th, and then Denise Jackson on January 12th. I can't overstate how excited I am to be hearing from our very own Crossroads family spiritual leaders. 2023 is going to be an amazing, God-filled, God-empowered, God-moving year. And we as a family have to make sure that we are doing all we can on our part to seek him, to be led by him, and to be guided by him. It's all gonna happen January 2023 during Launch Week. I can't wait to see you there.
If you're new to Crossroads Church today and would like to learn more, make sure to fill out a Connect card. You can turn it into the offering or bring it to guest reception. It is located in the Welcome Center and we would love to meet with you. And we have a free gift for you.
How are we doing this morning, Crossroads family? Yes, who's excited about Launch 2023? Oh, it's gonna be so good. If you don't know me, my name is Adam. I'm the youth pastor here at Crossroads, and if you would allow me, I'd like to tell you just a little bit about ourselves. You see, here at Crossroads, we believe very strongly in four things, and we rest upon these four things. And the first one of those is salvation. We believe in speaking and being intentional about the name of Jesus Christ. Because you can't disciple people until they're saved, right? So we need to get the name of Jesus out there. We believe in that very strongly. We do that through our second pillar, which is missions. We believe that every one of us has a mission field. We have mission fields at home, at work, in our schools, in this city, and around the world. That is how we spread the name of Jesus and bring people to salvation. We believe in creativity. Woo, we have some creative people here at Crossroads Church. Come on, give it up for our creative people here at Crossroads Church, from our worship team to It's a Wonderful Life coming up January 16th to 18th. You're going to make sure and catch that. It's an awesome time. And then we believe in diversity. We want the inside of this church to look how heaven's going to look. And that is every shade, color, type, everything. We want them all in this sanctuary. God is so good. It's so good to be in his house this morning, just to have an opportunity to gather and worship and lift the name of Jesus. Well, I'm going to invite the ushers forward now as it is time for tithes and offering. Yes, it is a privilege to be obedient to God. And if you would, please bow your heads with me and let's pray this morning. Heavenly Father, yes, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you for the opportunity to be here in your house. We thank you for the opportunity to speak and lift up the name of Jesus. We thank you for the opportunity to love one another, to encourage one another, to comfort one another, to strengthen one another, Lord. Let us come together as a family, as a true family, as the body of Christ, and unite in your love and do amazing things in your power, not in ours. Father, we thank you. I thank you for every penny that is being given this morning, Lord. I pray that we all give from a thankful, from a joyful heart. I pray that you would do miracles with the money that is given, that it would work exponentially, that we would see how long and powerful your arm is with what you accomplish through us. Father, we love you, we praise you, we worship you. You deserve it all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lights, please.
I've got the worship band up here. They're going to help in just a quick moment. Good morning. We're excited. I want to give a quick preference here. We are starting a new series this morning entitled The Magic of Christmas. Now, I got to give a quick disclaimer. I think everybody knows this. We don't believe in magic. But worth talking about the awe and wonder of the Christmas season. And truth be told, the magic of Christmas fit a lot better on the screen than the awe and wonder of Christmas. So we're talking about that childlike awe and wonder that each of us experienced at the Christmas season. And, you know, more than anything else, we remember those traditions that were carved in stone. We remember, you know, the smells of Christmas, pine needles, pumpkin pie, turkey, ham, the sights of Christmas lights, decorations, etc. And especially those incredible Christmas specials and Christmas movies that we watched as a child. So for the next few weeks, we're going to be kind of looking back at these beloved Christmas specials. I'm going to use them as a springboard to help us unpack the joy of the holiday season. So this week, I've got the worship band here to help me. And the title of my message is Christmas Treasures. And we are going to, they've got a song that's going to help us introduce the first Christmas special, the first message of this week. So would you just give it up for our wonderful worship band as they perform a special song for you? Go ahead and give it up one more time for our worship band. I'm going to be having special elements over the next couple of weeks. In fact, you want to be here next week because we have actually a mini concert from our very own CC Brass and Company. They're going to be helping us out, so they're going to be doing some songs. If you have not heard our CC Brass and Company, trust me, they are worth the price of admission. They are absolutely phenomenal, and they're going to be helping us out next week. Well, obviously, we're talking about Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, the beloved claymation special song. I do not know if you know the origin of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Let me tell you real quick, he actually started as a coloring book in, I can't remember the store, Woolworth or a chain based out of Chicago, Illinois. They were trying to get people into the store and something for the kids. And so they were using these coloring books and different things to help get people into the store during the holiday season and decided it would be cheaper if they made up their own. And so one of their ad execs made up Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, which became a beloved classic. So we're actually going to use the Rankin-Bass claymation special to help us this morning. Let me give you, before we show the clip, I've got just a couple clips this morning to show you. But before we play the first one, let me give you a preface. If you've been living under a rock over the last, 60, 70 years and have never heard of Rudolph, let me just tell you very quickly, obviously a mythical reindeer that has a big, bright, shiny nose. And he finds himself as an outcast. And in the claymation special, he's an outcast along with an elf by the name of Herbie, who wants to be a dentist. And he is shunned. I was going to say, Steve, I know it's crazy to think, Doc Heron's like, dentists unite. But they find themselves as outcasts. And they decide to shun societal norms and go off on their own adventure, and they end up getting actually in more trouble and danger than ever. So if you would turn your attention to the screen, and let's watch a little recap of the first part of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
We'll call him Rudolph.
Rudolph is a lovely name. Rudolph.
Hey, he knows his name already.
Papa, Mama. He's got a shiny nose.
Shiny? I'd even say it glows.
Well, we'll simply have to overlook it.
Now, how can you overlook that? His beak blinks. Herbie! Aren't you finished painting that yet? There's a pile up a mile wide behind you. What's eating you, boy?
Not happy in my work, I guess.
What? Oh, listen, you're an elf, and elves make toys. Now get to work.
No, I just can't. It's like he said, I'll never fit in.
Crying out loud.
Fireball, what's the matter?
Get away. Get away from me.
Now. What's this nonsense here, Bucks? After all,
yeah! Hey, look at the beak.
Hey, buy us new.
Fireball, boss.
Right now.
Stop calling me names.
Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
It's a deal.
We're a couple of misfits, we're a couple of misfits. What's the matter with misfits? That's where we fit in. We're not happy and silly, don't go round willy-nilly. Seems to us kind of silly that we don't fit in.
Who all remembers that? I know some of us, like me right now, watching it just kind of being taken back to my childhood. I know you're probably sitting there thinking, now where is he going to go with this? How can we bring out something redeeming in this? Unfortunately, Rudolph, over the last 10, 15 years, has, he's become the anthem of misfits, the anthem of outcasts. And unfortunately, stories like Rudolph at Christmas time have been used to begin pushing a certain social agenda, which is if you don't fit neatly into society's quote-unquote oppressive mold, forget about everything, forget about everyone else, and just go crazy. Just do what you want, and the world will eventually come around to accepting your personal preferences. This is not the intention of the poem, the song, the coloring book. Rudolph finds himself as an outcast. He finds himself rejected by those around him. But eventually, as you'll see later in the next clip, he finds worth and value in the eyes of Santa Claus. He finds, and Herbie does as well, not in spite of his differences, but because he's uniquely made. Value, self-worth, purpose is not found in shaking a fist at convention or society and living however you want, expecting everybody else to come around and accepting your preferences. No, no, value, self-worth, and purpose are all found deep within our identity. In fact, there's an old saying that says something is only worth what someone is willing to pay for it. So what are you and I worth? See, treasures are only treasures to those who seek them out. We're talking about Christmas treasures this morning. So my goal this morning is to encourage everyone here today, you are a treasure. You are a treasure sought out by not just a person. You are sought out not just by an organization. You are sought out not by an ideal or corporation. No, no, no. You are treasured and you are sought out by the one and only King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Your value, your worth, your purpose, your identity is found in Him and Him alone. And trying to find your value and your identity in anything else is a cheap substitute. Doesn't matter what the world says about you. You're king. You are the child of the King. You're a child of the King. And when I understand that, and when I get that down into my very core being, and I understand that my value is found in Him, my identity is found in Him, then I live my life for Him. I live my life for an audience of one. Why? Because He's the only audience worth living for. The Creator of the universe, the magnificent former and shaper of the world that you and I know, the one who spoke stars in the galaxy and spun them into existence, thinks you are a treasure. This morning, we're going to look at a parable found in the book of Matthew, chapter 13. It is found in verse 44. That's it, one verse. We're going to focus on one verse this morning. In fact, it's two short sentences. Let me read it for you this morning. Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then, in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field." Bow your heads with me this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the power, the transformative power in your word. I pray right now that our minds would be opened, our hearts would be open to receive this wonderful transformative power. Let your Holy Spirit speak to us and lead us into all truth. I pray that we would open our ears. I pray that somebody in this room this morning or watching online would hear and understand the life-changing truth that is found in these two short sentences. We thank you for all this. We glorify you and praise you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. I know you're probably thinking, oh, he's really going to preach out of just two sentences? Yep. Yes, I am. You know, I was thinking through this and praying through these two short sentences, and I think this is one of the reasons why Jesus often said, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Because our problem today is we move so fast. We listen, but we don't hear. We don't stop to really hear what is being said. We look, but we don't see. We glance over passages. And in fact, I've often said there's no such thing as a flyover verse. There's no such thing as a verse in the Word of God that you just simply read and go, eh. That's less important than the other verses. In fact, when you read the Word of God, you should never go away from reading the Word of God. You should never close your Bible and say to yourself, "I got nothing out of that." Because every word is important, every word is critical. This is a parable that so often gets overlooked because of the brevity of the parable. It's just two short sentences. But within Matthew 13 holds all the nuance, all the context, all the subtlety of the entire gospel. Matthew 13:44 is a two-sentence snapshot of the entire gospel. It is a two-sentence snapshot of the entirety of Scripture. See, anytime, and I want to encourage you with this, anytime we read a parable in the Word of God, you need to stop and ask yourself this question: who am I in this story? Who am I? You see, and the great thing is about these parables, the great thing is about the complexity and the layers of Jesus' teaching, there have been several times and several seasons in my life that I've felt and I've identified with every character, with every person that is referenced. In this story right here, there have been times in my life where I've identified with the man and that there are things that God is revealing in my life that I need to cherish and treat as treasures. There have been times I felt like the dirt that covered up the treasure. What am I doing? Am I covering up somebody else's treasure and giftings? What am I doing in my life that is smothering and stifling somebody else's calling and their giftings? But for the sake of my message this morning, I want to talk to you about the most straightforward interpretation of this parable. And that is that God is the man and you are the treasure found in a field. I want to give and unpack three thoughts from these two sentences. Number one, the man found what others discarded. The man found what others discarded. You see, it's a short parable, so we don't have a lot of, you know, information and data that is given. All we know is this: number one, it was a treasure. Number two, it was left in a field. Man found it. See, all we really know from reading this is that the man who found it considered it a treasure. But the sheer fact that it was left in a field lets you and I know that there was somebody else, another man, who did not consider it a treasure. In fact, there's that old saying we've often heard it before: one man's trash is another man's treasure. Let me talk to you very briefly about the difference between trash and treasure. I got thinking and praying about this. What's the difference between trash and treasure? Because if you think about it, both items, both trash and treasure, were at least at one time cherished by their owner. Both served a purpose. Both were held in high esteem at one time or another. And they were cared for. You see, but here's the thing: treasures are valuable because they are cared for. Treasures are valued because, and they have value because they're cared for. Let me give you an example. Every person has a grandmother, an aunt, or somebody with a room full of knickknacks. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Those little precious moments, porcelain dolls, those little dolls that are just, I mean, as a kid, they're kind of creepy. You know, they stare at you with those hollow eyes. You know what I'm talking about? Those porcelain dolls, and they're just like, they're creepy now, yeah. Some adults are going, kid, nothing. I'm scared now. And here's the thing. Some of those dolls, you couldn't sell those things in a yard sale, or even you couldn't give them away. You'd pay somebody else to take them. Please take this doll, please. No thanks. I've had way too many nightmares. No, thank you. But here's the thing. They are treasured to whoever that family member is. And do they bring any value? Does it matter? Because they're treasured. You see, they have value in that person's life because they care for them. Now let's think about something else. Now let's think about trash. Trash is cared for because it brings value. And when it no longer brings value or perceived value, it becomes what? Trash. I mean, think about everything that is sitting in your garbage can at home right now. At one point, it brought value to your life. That empty soda bottle carried soda. Or if you're in the South, pop. Even that empty Kleenex box filled with nothing but tissue paper brought value to your life at one time. And if you've ever had a cold or a runny nose, you know the value of having Kleenexes on hand. But then that value, it gets used up, it gets fulfilled, the purpose gets fulfilled, and then it no longer carries value. See, how does this hit home, this thought hit home to us today? I don't know about you, but I know what it feels like to be used up for a purpose and then discarded when I no longer bring perceived purpose or value to a person or situation. I don't know about you, but I know what it feels like to feel like trash that was discarded along the road. Anybody else know what I'm talking about? To feel like life has thrown you into a field and has buried you for nobody else to find? We've all felt used. We've all felt expendable. In fact, our world will teach us that everything is expendable. I mean, let's get real. Somewhere in this church is an overhead projector built to 1960-something. The light bulb still works. You plug it in, and it works. But you can go out today and buy a brand new refrigerator for $3,000, and you'd be happy if you got 5 years out of it. Everything's expendable. I want to encourage you today. You're not expendable. Amen. You're not expendable. Amen. And it's not just about perceived value that you can bring to somebody else. No, 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 no. You are treasured. You are the treasure in the field. And God has found you. And He treasures you. You have value because you're cared for. Amen. The thing about that room full of knickknacks are those items that family members have that bring quote-unquote sentimental value, it doesn't matter what the stock market says, right? Oh, come on, this is going to be good for somebody today. Doesn't matter what the stock market says, those items are not for sale, right? Those items are not for sale. They can't be bought, they can't be bribed, they can't be swindled away. No, why? Because they have too much value. You are treasured. The creator of the universe, the all-creative God, the most powerful, powerful ruler, king, finds you as a treasure. He cares for you. I don't want anybody in this place to feel like they've been discarded. Because that's simply not the truth. You are treasured. Second point. Second thought is He gave everything. Everybody say everything. Everything. He gave everything. Well, what was the cost of this field? How much did... the parable says He went and sold everything. Sold everything. The main point is that it didn't matter what the cost was. It didn't matter what the cost was. The man was willing to pay whatever the cost was. Let's talk about the obvious. You know, we deal with money, right? I got thinking about this just this morning and added it to my notes. If you think about it, you know, when you think of making a purchase, right? Oh, Kleenexes. Let's go back to Kleenexes because they're right here. You know, there was a time when this would cost a dollar. The way things are going now, it's like, $5, $10, you gotta take out a second mortgage to buy a box of Kleenexes or anything nowadays. It just, prices are skyrocketing, you know. But let's say $5. This thing's worth $5. You think that the value of this is $5. So you exchange and it's of equal value. But if you really think about it, if you really think about it, when it comes to true value, this is actually worth more than $5. Because it's worth that little extra that causes you to go to the store to exchange $5 for this. Does that make sense? So it brings a little extra added value. And what it can do, if it truly only it was valued the exact same as $5, you would blow your nose on the $5 bill, right? Because who wants to go to the store? And when I got a $5 here and it's worth exactly the same, so this brings a little extra added value. Does that make sense to you? Because it's worth the hassle of transaction. It's worth the hassle of transaction. So think about this. He considers the treasure in the field worth the hassle, worth the process, worth the transaction. He goes and liquidates everything that he owns. And the parable says that he does it gladly. The process is worth it for him. The sacrifice is worth it for him. Whatever it is, we don't know what the treasure is. We just know that it's a treasure and he considers it a treasure. Whatever it is worth the sacrifice. A couple thousand years ago, God sent his greatest treasure to this earth. And he considered it worth the sacrifice. Jesus came. And he didn't just, I think sometimes we gloss over, but we shouldn't gloss over the process. Because we just think that, you know, Jesus sent his son and he paid the debt. This wasn't like a financial transaction. You know, God didn't show up at, you know, the heavenly Walmart and say, here's my son. You know, cha-ching, check out, everything's good, transaction is done. No, there was a process that took years and years. Number one, it took thousands of years to prepare the earth to receive the Messiah, for the scriptures to be fulfilled, and that Jesus came and he lived a perfect life, fulfilling all of the Old Testament scriptures. About 300 to 400 prophecies were fulfilled by Jesus. All of that took a process. And then on top of that, he was brutally murdered by crucifixion. This is what Jesus does for us. God sending his son, Jesus giving his life willingly for you and I, gave up everything. He gives everything. His greatest treasure he gives. I think where we often get mixed up in our world today is we treat our treasures like a resource and we treat our resources like a treasure. Think about it. There's a reason why we can gladly go pay $5 for a box of tissues. A couple reasons. Number one, blowing your nose on a $5 bill, I mean, that's pretty painful. It's not designed for that. What's it designed for? It's designed to be used and exchanged. Why? It's a resource. Let's get real, guys. Money is designed to be spent, to be used, to be put into use. And the goal is to use it wisely. Right? So cars are meant to be driven. Houses are meant to be lived in. Listen, there is a mother and a father out there with kids. I know I've got four of them. Let me help you. Let me relieve some pressure on your life. Okay? Your house is not a museum. You don't live in a museum. You live in a house. So when you get home today and you see a sink full of dirty dishes, that's okay. When you see the beds all, you know, unmade, and your kids come in and socks come off, they just drop wherever that shoe drops, right there in the middle of the floor. And, you know, it's just, and you're stepping over stuff, and it's, you know, the dogs are chewing up everything. That's okay. Somebody's got to live there, all right? You're meant to live there, not be a museum. Just, whew. Why? Because the house is meant to be lived in. Resources are meant to be used, but so often in life, we treat our resources like treasures. We put them up, and we elevate them. We put them on a pedestal and say, oh, that money, oh, that can't do it. Oh, that's the most important thing in life. No, it's not. It's a resource, but God is the source. So stop treating the resource like the source, and stop treating the source, which is God, like a resource. He treats you like a treasure. He treats you like a treasure. You are a treasure in God's sight. And I love this because as I think through this, I can trust the faithfulness of God. While the world will try to use me up and the world will try to get what it can out of me and then cast me aside, I know that my God will never will. He'll never do that. Why? Because he sees me as a treasure. He gave everything. Let me talk about the third thought. He bought what he could have taken. He bought what he could have taken. Let's get real. Can we get real this morning? I've read this for this parable for years and years and years, and it used to bother me, used to trouble me. Because I'm sitting here thinking, what about the time-old universal law of finders, keepers, losers, weepers? Right? I mean, that goes back to like, you know, Mesopotamian, you know, ancient Greek society, I mean, Babylonian culture. I mean, that's like as long as there's been humanity, there's been the universal law of finders, keepers, losers, weepers. And I'm sitting here thinking, the guy's walking down the road and he's walking through a field and he finds this treasure. I'm thinking, slip, put the treasure in a bag and be on my merry way. Right? Did he really have to go sell everything? Did he really have to go buy the field in order to get the treasure that's in the field? That's absolutely ridiculous. Let's talk about this. Why would this man do this? And this is critical for you and I to understand. Are you still with me today? It's critical to understand. If you look at Old Testament tradition, you know, every 7 years is a year of forgiveness and every 50 years is a year of jubilee, which meaning all debts are forgiven. Land gets reverted back to original owners, things that occur in a Jewish cultural context. So the reason why he did not just take the treasure is because he wanted to go about the right process. He wanted to do everything above board. In fact, we see this echoed in the Gospel of John. John chapter 10 says that the sheep know my voice. I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd goes through the right gate. Anybody who does not go through the right gate or go through the proper channels is not a good shepherd, is only has nefarious goals, is a thief. But he says the good shepherd goes through the right process. The right process. You see, this man did not want anybody to come and lay claim at a later date to the treasure. He didn't want anybody to say, ah, he stole it. That really belongs to me. He wanted upright ownership of the treasure. So he did what it required in order for him to go about the right process. I often tell, and I've told teenagers, anybody who's thinking of, you know, getting married or they're in love with that special somebody, you know how it is when you're 15 years old and you think, this is it, I found the one. I'm 14 and that's it, I'm in love. I tell people, you know how I knew that Talina was the one for me? I knew she was the one for me. I knew she was the one I wanted to truly marry when I voluntarily did all the things that I used to scoff at when I was a teenager. All the things that Sunday school teachers told me to do, all the things that youth pastors told me to do, people like my parents told me to do that I used to scoff and go, whatever, I don't need to do any of that. I wanted to do those things. Like, for instance, have an accountability partner in the relationship, you know. Pray with Talina, read the Word of God together. Schedule our dates to where we're not just driving around on some back road somewhere. Y'all know what I'm talking about? All these things that as a teenager was like, I don't need to do any of that. I wanted all those guardrails that I scoffed at as a high school student and a college student. When we started dating, I said, no, I want those guardrails. Why? Because I want to go about this process correctly. In anything in life, let me encourage you, ask yourself, how am I going about this process? Because evil seeks the dark corners of any room and any space. But truth and good always seek the light. So if you find yourself, let me encourage you, if you find yourself having conversations with a coworker that you feel the need to cover up and slide into the back corner so nobody knows, check yourself. Check yourself. Are you, everybody following me? If you find yourself entering into business deals where you start to think to yourself, oh, I don't know if people need to know about this. I'm going to try to hide this. I'm going to try to keep it, you know, kind of quote unquote close to the vest. Check yourself. Check yourself. And I love this, and this encourages me, because when I put this into context with this passage, when I think about God seeking me out, He did everything appropriately. He did everything appropriately. You know, He could have sent His Son Jesus down as a conqueror and done things completely different, but He didn't. Why? Because the wages of sin is death. The penalty for my sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. He sent His Son, and He went about the process in public, in the open, so that there could never be anybody to lay claim to you or I. No agenda of this world, no person within this world, Satan himself, cannot lay claim to us. Why? Because we are children of the King. We are bought with the blood of the Lamb of God, the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world, who gave everything and who went through the appropriate process to purchase our salvation correctly. Let's check back in with Rudolph in our second clip, as Rudolph finds value and purpose in the eyes of Santa.
Rudolph, I promise, as soon as this storm lets up, I'll find homes for all those misfit toys.
All right, you can open up a dentist's office next week after Christmas.
Come here, open your mouth.
Oh,
dear. I better set up an appointment for you week from Tuesday, 4:30, sharp.
Oh, this is it. The storm won't subside by tonight. We'll have to cancel Christmas. That beautiful, wonderful nose.
Huh?
Rudolph, Christmas is not off, and you're going to lead my team.
I am?
Yes, sir. You and that wonderful nose of yours.
My nose, sir?
Oh, from what I see now, that'll cut through the murkiest storm they can dish up. What I'm trying to say is, Rudolph, with your nose so bright, won't you guide my sleigh tonight?
Have a holly jolly Christmas. It's the best time of the year. I don't know if there'll be snow, but have a cup of cheer. Have a holly jolly Christmas. And when you walk down the street, say hello to friends you know and everyone you meet.
hung where you can see. Why use this as an illustration? Why use this as a backdrop or a springboard? Let me take a quick moment to just share my heart with you. There are a lot of things, a lot of traditions, a lot of things that we experience as we go through life. And the Word of God tells us to walk circumspectly and redeem the time. Redeem the time. I know at one point between now and Christmas, you're going to sit down with family members and you're going to watch this thing in its entirety, you know. And if you're anything like me, you know, after the first 30 seconds of it, of the nostalgia, that'll all wear off and you're like, this is not nearly as good as I remember as a kid. But here's the thing. Take the opportunity. When you see this, talk to your kids about the man who found the treasure in a field and how the treasure's value is found in the eyes of the man. And just like Santa finds value in Rudolph, not in spite of his differences, but because he's different, encourage your children. Encourage your family members. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. Redeem the time. I can't help but remember when Talina and I, when we got engaged, I took her to my home church to show her off and show off the ring to everybody. You know, Trip, my grandmother, who's gone on to be with the Lord, sat down right next to her. Didn't say a word to her, just grabbed her left hand and yanked it up and looked at it, real intent. And looked at my fiance and said, it's a pretty nice ring. Yes, ma'am. Do you think you're worth it? So I love my wife. Instead of shrinking back, instead of apologizing and retreating, she looked at her right in the eye and said, your grandson seems to think I am. And they are best friends from that moment on. See, that captures the heart of this message today. Didn't matter if my grandmother thought that my fiance was worth the price or worth the ring, worth the money that I spent to get her the ring in order for us to get married. The most important part was, Mark thinks I'm worth it. I'm worth it in his eyes. You see, so when the world comes at you, when life throws you down, when people in your world try to tell you that you're not worth it, doesn't matter. Because you can hold your head up high and you can square your shoulders back and say, you know what? He thinks I'm worth it. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords thinks I'm worth it, and I'm a treasure that was found in a field. I was discarded. You may have counted me out. You may have left me for dead. You may have thrown me out with the trash. You may have said, he ain't worth nothing. He's not worth the ink printed, used to print his birth certificate. He's not worth nothing. But you know what? God thinks that I'm worth it. He found me. He picked me up. He dusted me off. He went through the proper channels and he gave everything because he thinks I'm worth it. And when I encounter that kind of love and that kind of grace, I can't help but want to live my life for him. I can't help but want to be a better husband. I can't help but want to be a better father. I can't help but want to be a better man. Why? Because he thinks I'm worth it. You're worth it today. If everybody would stand across this place. You might have walked in this room feeling discarded. You might have walked in this room feeling like nobody cares. Know this, God cares for you. And this is your opportunity. You might feel like life has covered you over and you've been left out in the wind and the rain. Nobody cares. Nobody sees you. God sees you today. Today is your opportunity to respond to the grace of God with faith. With faith. It's the amazing thing about our God. He sees us, he finds us, he seeks us out, and he purchased us with the blood of Jesus, and he still gives us a choice. to choose him or not, today is your choice. And I pray that you would make the choice to choose Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, to choose him to be the Lord of your life, to choose him in return to his seeking you out. If everybody would bow your heads and close your eyes, this is a personal moment. I want to ask just right now, point blankly, would you, if you feel like this is you, would you raise your hand to say, yeah, I want to make Jesus Christ the Lord of my life. I want to make him the Savior. I want to ask him into my heart to be the Lord of my life, whether for the first time or maybe the first time in a long time. You know, you need to come back home to him. Right now is your moment. Right now is your opportunity. Don't let it pass by. If that's you, would you simply slip a hand up in the air so we can pray with you today? Is there anybody in this room? I'm just going to wait for a moment. Okay. Well, I feel that there's nothing left for us to do but to rejoice and to celebrate. I want to encourage you today. We're going to ask the worship band to play a song. And you know what? Can we play Never Lost? Let's play that one. I'm switching it up on him. Because he's never lost a battle. You know what? He's never lost a treasure. He's never lost a battle. He never will. Because he loves you so much. We're going to have the elders up here to pray with you if you need prayer for anything. Sickness, a family member, whatever it might be. We're going to be here with you. But right now, can we respond in thanks and gratitude? Because he found us. And he gave everything. He gave everything. And he went through the proper channels so you and I, could be his treasure. Let's worship God just for the next few moments. Elders are going to come. They can pray with you. But let's respond. Can we respond together and give thanks to God because he has found us and he has saved us?
Miracles when you move, such an easy thing for you to do. Your hand is moving right now. You are still showing up at the tomb of every Lazarus. Your voice is calling me out. And right now, I know you're able, and my God will come through again. You can do all things.
Hallelujah.
You can do all things but fail. 'Cause you never lost a battle. No, you never lost a battle. And I know, you never win. Everything's possible by the power of the Holy Ghost. A new wind is growing right now.
Oh, yeah.
Breaking my heart of stone, taking over like the Jericho. And my walls are all crashing down. And right now, I know you're able. And my God will come through again. You can do all things.
Oh, yes.
You can do all things but fail. 'Cause you never a battle. No, you never lost a battle. And I know, I
Give God just a round of applause this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you that you've never lost a battle. We thank you that you are faithful. We thank you that you found us. You found us like a treasure in a field. Even though the world might have discarded us, even though we might have counted ourselves out, you see value in us and you love us. And you redeem us, you make us valuable. So Lord, I pray that we would just walk in your strength, we would walk in your power, we would walk in your might. And Lord, if anybody is facing an obstacle, facing a mountain, I pray that you would do something supernatural in their lives. I pray that you would open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing upon every relationship, every marriage, every home, every business relationship. And I just pray, Holy Spirit, go before us, lead us and guide us as we strive to live for you. We thank you for all these things. We glorify you and praise you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Elders are going to remain up front just for a few minutes if you need prayer for anything. But otherwise, you are dismissed today. If you're new to Crossroads, please stop off in our welcome center at a guest reception. We have a gift for you, and I would love to meet you and hear your story. God bless you. Have a wonderful afternoon, and we will see you next week.
I don't have to wait till the battle's over.